Bienvenidos amigos de YouTube a un nuevo video, una nueva entrevista. Viajamos a los 80s y vamos a aprovechar porque estamos cumpliendo en aniversario 40 años de uno de los mayores éxitos de esta artista. Vamos a estar hablando con Hazel Dean en este año 2024 que cumple 40 años este hit del High Energy Searching. So welcome Hazel, welcome to my YouTube channel.
Well, it's lovely to be here.
You know, I really love Searching, you know, and I want to know about everything of this song, you know, this high energy song. I really love the style of the music. So I know that you work with Ian Stephens, so I want to know about the beginnings of this great hit, you know.
Okay, I'll do my best. I have to go back in my mind to remember, but I do remember most of it. Well, I've been in the music really all my life, from a 13-year-old girl at school learning to play the guitar, being in school bands. In the 70s, I did turn professional, mm-hmm. and I worked with lots of big bands. I started in a small sort of group, and then eventually in England we have, back in those days anyway, we had lots of big bands like your Glenn Miller type of thing, but doing pop music as well, and we'd do lots of cover versions, mm-hmm. and that was a very big thing back then over here. So there'd be lots of places to sing live, work with big bands. So I was very lucky because I think today you don't get that as much. Mm. It's not a big thing anymore, although we do have Strictly Come Dancing, of course. But back in those days, I worked with lots of live bands all through the 70s, all over the country, sometimes traveling to different countries. So that was my life before I had hit records.
Great.
Plus, I am a bit of a musician as well. In late 70s, I started to do writing songs and stuff like that. And I also did a lot of session work in studios, mm-hmm. Backing vocals for other artists. So I covered a lot of things. So they were my early days.
Why high energy?
Well, it's not what I wanted to do to begin with, to be honest with you. I sort of grew up in the 60s as a teenager. I used to love people like Cilla Black. I don't know if you know these people in your country. Yeah. Cilla Black, Dusty Springfield, big fan of the Beatles. I wanted to sing ballads and all that kind of stuff. Because, mm-hmm. as you know, I've got quite a big voice. But obviously, as we moved forward into the, I also like soul music. I like singing a lot of soul stuff as well. But as we moved forward into the 80s, obviously the music changed and images changed. And so I guess for a little while, maybe I was a bit lost as to where was I going to go? What kind of stuff was I going to do? But then in 1983, I heard from a guy called Ian Anthony Stephens. And I actually, going back to the 70s, mm-hmm. For a second, I did actually have a record deal in the 70s on Decca Records in the UK.
Okay.
And we used to, up in the north of England, we used to have a big thing called Northern Soul. I don't know if you've ever heard of that. You probably have. And my old records, they were quite high energy, very Gloria Gaynor sort of a feel to them. So I had some songs out. And they were big, they were very big on the Northern Soul scene, which I had no idea at the time that was happening, but they were. And that's how Ian heard my voice. So going back now to the 80s, he presented me with a song, this track, Searching. He sent it to me and he tried it out with a couple of people. It wasn't sort of working for them. Mm-hmm. And it was just so, it was early 80s, 83, it was just so different from anything else I'd ever sort of heard. It was so different from everything else that was going on at that moment in time. Yeah. And I just loved it. I thought it was different, unusual. And yeah, I was very keen to sing that track. So Ian and I met up. He came to my home at the time. And we set up going into the studio to record Searching. So that's how that sort of situation came about. And we recorded it in May of 1983
in London. Wow. You say, was you record that song, I feel that it was very fast, you know, everything. But did you feel that, okay, when you record that song, okay, this is going to be a hit, you know?
Well, I did personally. I always thought it was very special. I think a lot of people around me at the time weren't sure, but I do have a good ear for songs, and I just know when something is special, and that was really special because it was so different. And also with Searching, the people that had done the demos, in the chorus, instead of going up the octave, they were singing down the octave. So the chorus just didn't go Searching. It just didn't happen.
Yeah.
And so I changed that around, and to be honest, that made the difference.
Oh,
but it's such a great song, and lyrically it's very good. And it was just a pleasure.
Nice. You know, I was watching the videos of Searching on YouTube. I love read the comments, you know, the opinion of the people. There's a lot of message from, for example, Central America, Nicaragua, Guatemala, Ecuador, you know. For example, it has this is a message of Kelly on one of your videos on Pop the Pops. Every time I hear this song, it brings you back to the 80s. Here's to you, Hasseldine. Thank you for the great memories, you know. Other experiences, like I was 18 when this was in the charts. I used to dance to this in Birmingham, for example.
Yeah.
You know, the people have a lot of good memories, you know.
They do. And I mean, obviously I get all that kind of stuff on my Facebook, and it's lovely. I mean, it's so nice that I still, you know, get all these comments from all these people. Yeah. It's lovely.
How it was being there working with Ian Stephens?
Ian, yeah. I mean, I have worked with him since, but Ian's lovely, you know, and he was very easy to work with. You know, I would say this is how I want to do it, like going up the octave and stuff like that. And he was absolutely cool about it. He loved it. He loved the finished thing. So, we worked really well together.
Cool. And I want to know, because you work with a lot of great producers, you know, for example, this group, Sov, you know, Stokes, Aikman and Waterman. I want to know about your experiences of being there working with those guys.
Mm-hmm. well, again, you see, I'd worked with Pete Waterman before, because we did it, funny enough, he put together a song I wrote called Stay in My Life. Which was, I entered for Song for Europe in 1984. And so that's kind of, I bumped into him a few times in different studios.
Mm-hmm.
And he's quite a character. And usually, Peter, you can hear him before you actually see him. He's very funny. He's a real character, but he's got a great ear for a song, pop songs. And he had been working with, I was on a little label in those days, on an independent label called Proto Records. And he also had he was working on a track. In the first thing he ever did was Stock Aitken with Matt and Mike.
Mm-hmm.
And called Agents Aren't Aeroplanes. And so I just happened to be at Proto Records one day. Searching was at number 6 in the UK charts in 84. And Pete Waterman was in the studio having a meeting, and I bumped into him and we started having a conversation, and he said, well, what's happening? I said, well, I've got to look for a follow-up, because at that point in time, I did not have a follow-up for Searching.
No.
So we had a little conversation. He said, oh, you should come down and meet these two guys I'm working with, which was Mike Stock and Matt Atkin. And so I did. I said, okay, that's it, great, fantastic. So I went down to Marquee Studio, where they were working at the time. And they were working on a track for Divine for Proto Records. And it was You Think You're a Man. You think you're a man. I just heard that backing track and went, oh, yeah. this is perfect. This yeah. Absolutely, I want this. Yeah, and that's, it happened as quickly. And we had to move really quickly. So they came up, they sent me a song, and at the time it was called, I think it was called Dance Your Love Away, which was the verse that, you know, Whatever I Do, Wherever I Go, the second single, it was the verse of that song. And then, but the chorus wasn't the Whatever I Do that we now know and love. It was something else. And being a bit of a songwriter myself, I just said, well, I love the verse. It's fantastic. I said, but the chorus just for me just doesn't work. So he said, okay. And Mike and Matt went off and did what they had to do. And they sent me another demo within a couple of days. I mean, they worked really quickly because they wanted this. And I came back and they came up with the chorus of Whatever I Do. And I went in and we recorded it at the Marquee studio. No, we didn't do that at the Marquee, actually. We did that somewhere else. Another studio in London, anyway, big studio. And we had to sort of, I mean, we had to roll it around really quickly because obviously Searching sat at number six, I think, for 2 or 3 weeks. But once it started going down, you need that. Yeah. The next single out. And we managed to pull it off. I think being on an independent label at the time, it was easier to do that rather than we weren't on a major. So we were able to sort of get it out. And then again, I was, the rest is history, as they say. So that's, and I gave them their first top five single back in 1984.
Yeah, so true. Well, you talk about Divine, you know, I really love Divine. I love all the music of Glenn Milstead. Did you meet her or did you meet him? You know, please?
Yeah. Oh, many times. Divine's manager, a chap called Bernard Jay, he used to manage me in the States, in America. Mm-hmm. He used to look after me over there. So that's how I got to meet Divine. But yeah, I became very friendly with Divine actually because he sort of invited me to his apartment in New York, which was spectacular at the time. Mm-hmm. And he was a bit wary of me at first, I have to say. Oh. He thought that I might sort of take Bernard Jay, his manager, away from him. But, you know, I didn't, of course. And but no, I had a good relationship with Divine. He was very funny. When he was out of his drag, he was such a lovely, sweet man, a really, really nice man.
Oh, so cool, so cool. Yeah. I love You Think You're a Man. It's a great song, too, from the High Energy. Yes. I know that that song have a few problems in the UK, because about the dress.
I'll tell you a little thing. That song was originally written for me.
Wow.
Funnily enough. But having said that, you know, it worked great with Divine because it was so funny. Now, Divine did our Top of the Pops. Do you know Top of the Pops here in the UK?
Course.
And basically, he was banned. A lot of people didn't sort of like how he was, how he looked, didn't think it was right. So, you know, that was 1984. So he was banned. He was banned from the BBC.
Yeah.
So it sort of ruined obviously he couldn't do any more sort of televisions. Well, he did, I think he did some sort of late night things. There was one at the time called, what was it called? The Tube or something like that on Channel 4 over here. Mm. Which was very alternative, and so he was on that, and he could be Divine. Top of the Pops, oh no.
No.
So, yeah.
Well, you know, just talking about this, you know, I want to know about your opinion, you know, of the change, if we talk about the gay community in those times, now in this current period, you know, in your opinion, no, the changes that this community have.
Well, obviously things were very different back then, and it was tougher, and we had AIDS, and so that made life, you know, made life very difficult for everybody. Mm. But obviously since then, you know, I think things have, I think things are much better. Although, you know, I think we're going through a tough time at the moment. Mm-hmm. Trans people especially are really having a bad time over here.
Yeah.
And I am a supporter. I'm an ally. So in one way, yes, things have moved on. Things are a whole lot better. But it's almost like, you know, back in then when we had Clause 28 going on and all those horrible things that were happening, and I was sort of part of all that thing. I did loads of stuff in those days, you know, for those causes. And I'm doing the same thing now for the trans community. So that it just hasn't moved on, and they're having a real tough time. So in one way, yes, things have moved on a lot. It's a lot easier to be open and be gay, but you know, still we still have this situation going on for our trans friends.
Do you feel that the 80s was the period of the changes? Because when we talk about Divine, Sylvester James, for example, we don't talk only about music, you know, we talk about just being there, you know, dressing like a woman, you know, in those times, in those periods. You say that was a hard period, you know. I don't know if the 80s was the big period of the changes.
Well, you know? Well, I think it probably was. In a way, I think it all started then because you know, people start to say, well, I am gay, I want to be who I am. And I think so that's, it did all start then really. And I get, you know, coming out of the AIDS situation and the whole Clause 28 made people want to say, no, I'm going to be who I am. And we have our gay prides and to say, this is who we are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What's that awful? Oh, I used to hate that saying. What was it? I'm queer, but I'm here, sort of thing. So I guess the gay prides, you know, helped a lot, and I sang at gay prides for sort of 38 years, I think, because I retired in 2021 doing live shows. So obviously I stopped doing all the gay prides, but people just got up and they went out and walked. And did parades and marched and say, we're here, we're here, we're queer, we're here.
Well, you know, we are in the 40th anniversary of Searching, and I want to know if this year is going to be new stuff, you know, new things.
Yeah, well, we're doing a big celebration for Searching, which we're having a party in London for 40 years, but we have got a new single coming out. There's lots of remixes on it. Ian Anthony Stevens has done some remixes, which is coming out on Fantasia Records. Mm-hmm. And we have our own remixes that we've done to celebrate that are coming out on SP Music. So there's lots of new remixes coming out. Wow. And just a big celebration really of 40 years. Got to do it.
Well, you know, the last one, maybe this is a good opportunity if you want to send a little message to all your fans, or not only fans, you know, but a little message to all those guys, women, people who've been there, you know, 40 years, you know, listen to your music.
Just want to say thank you so much for dancing and singing along to these, you know, fantastic records, great songs. I've had a ball as well, but thank you so much for all your support and your comments. I love them. Keep them coming. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Hazel. Thank you very much for your time. First, such an honor being here talking with you. So thanks a lot.
Well, it's lovely to talk to you as well. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Have a nice day there, okay?
I will do. Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.